I'm Auntie Newsom. If I haven't introduced myself to you, I'm the executive director of Carolina Public Press. And Carolina Public Press, for those of you who don't know us, we are a nonprofit news organization focused on in-depth and investigative reporting in the 18 westernmost counties. We focus on public interest reporting, so that means education, the environment, local, regional, state politics, crime, transportation, those types of issues. And we really want to focus on the issues that are most important to Western North Carolinians, things that we're dealing with right now, we may be dealing with in the future, and that includes water. So here we have our Newsmakers Forum on who owns Western North Carolina's water. So this is our third Newsmakers Forum, in which we really try to provide an opportunity for journalists who are working on the news to talk to the public and those that are in the news, experts, advocates, elected officials and others who are frequently in the news to be able to get together and talk about these important issues. So thank you so much for coming tonight. We really want this to go beyond sound bites and headlines. We're going to spend about an hour and a half together. Tonight, what you can expect is about 45 minutes of a panel discussion and then 45 minutes of a Q&A with all of you. So I'm really interested in hearing what you have to say about water management, ownership, and rights in Western North Carolina. And I'm really interested also, thanks for having, what these folks have to say too. I want to begin by saying we invited a lot, I mean a lot of people to this panel. We invited representatives from the North Carolina Utilities Commission, Aqua North Carolina, Utilities Incorporated, the North Carolina Utilities Commission, and the City of Asheville. And for various reasons, those folks were unable to come tonight. But we are really blessed and happy that the folks that came represent a really diverse group and opinions and experience with water, water infrastructure, and water ownership in Western North Carolina. So you all should have a bio sheet, but I do want to take a moment to introduce folks. To my left is Jack Igelman. You all may know him through some reporting that he does for Carolina Public Press. He's our lead environmental contributor. To his right is Lee Smith. He's the utilities director for Hendersonville Water and Sewer, has an impressive resume. In fact, everybody does, so just take some time to read the bios. I could probably go on for 10 pages with all the accolades these folks have had. Then we have Representative Chuck McGrady, who represents Henderson County. Colson, who's the director of the North Carolina Division of Water Infrastructure and chair of the State Water Infrastructure Authority. We have Katie Hicks, who's the Assistant Director of Clean Water for North Carolina, and John Elliston, who is the Investigations and Open Government Editor of Carolina Public Press. So John and Jack will be moderating the panel discussion. They'll have lots of questions for the first 45 minutes, and then we'll turn it over to you. And I'll be moderating the Q&A. So thank you again for all of you for persevering and coming tonight. I do want to thank the Community Foundation of Western North Carolina and the Innovation Fund, which is helping make these events possible with Carolina Public Press. We really sincerely appreciate their support. And let's get started. I'll turn it over to you, Jack.
Yeah, great. Thanks, Angie. And thanks for everyone for being here. It's such a great panel. And just to give you guys some background, I'm going to give the first question to Lee, but I wanted to point out that in Western North Carolina, we looked at some data of water systems, and there's roughly in the 18 counties that we cover, in the westernmost counties, there's 300 community water systems, that which means it serves more than 15 to 25 people. And 20% of those systems are government-operated systems. However, roughly 90% of the population gets their water from public water systems, such as the Hendersonville system that Lee manages. So we thought some of the reporting we've done has looked at public systems. And I wonder, Lee, if you could give us an idea of sort of the state of the infrastructure of the Hendersonville system, how many you serve, and just a little bit about how you address the infrastructure needs and how you pay for it.
Okay, we have approximately 640 miles of water mains, and that serves a population of about 62,000 people. and mostly in Henderson County, Hendersonville, Henderson County, Laurel Park, Mills River. We actually serve down into Polk County. We provide water to Saluda. Like I said, 640 miles of lines, a lot to keep up with. We've been in the water business since the late 1880s. We actually have the line that was put in service at that time, still in service. So we do have some old infrastructure. We have the bulk of our system, or at least the beginning of the core of our system, came about in the 20s, in the 1920s. And so we're dealing with some infrastructure that is approaching 100 years in age. And of course, we on the sewer side, we are in the same situation. We've got some old infrastructure from the 20s as well. And Hendersonville's approach to repair and replacement is right now is to try to fund what we can through our cash reserve, which is the monies that we acquire from our customers when they tie onto our system. We charge what's called a system development charge, and that is to help offset any costs that we may incur in the future to expand the plant, to replace existing lines that are either undersized or have just aged out. So those are the kinds of things that we're doing right now. We're trying to identify through several different methods where our infrastructure is the weakest, where, you know, we're looking at criticality, you know, if the line were to break, you know, looking at those kind of things. Looking at, we've just had a hydraulic model of our water system. We're just getting it up and running. So that will be a tool that we've never had. We will really be able to do a lot more work planning once we get that online and up and running. But that's, and we do borrow money. We've had three big sewer projects that have taken out, I think, five or six sewer pump stations, and one was our largest pump station, and have replaced it with gravity. So we're trying to reduce the number of pump stations that we have when it's possible, and try to go on the sewer side, try to go more with gravity. But we're doing the same thing on the water side as well.
Do you have a sense of the costs of some of these projects?
Oh, yes. our capital on the water side is about $72 million. And that's just what we've identified. And, you know, this is over 20 years, 20 or 30 years. So that's, you know, we're trying to chip away at it. Again, we're trying to sort of narrow down those parts of the system that really need the work now, and then try to put off areas where we don't need the work now, you know, for later.
And I guess that's one of the challenges. Things are underground, right? So explain exactly that. How do you identify where these projects need to happen?
On the water side, it's easy because we have camera equipment that we can put up, you know, in the sewer mains. So we can inspect the sewer mains. Water's a lot different. You have to base a lot of what you do on experience, knowledge of the system, age of the pipe. There's really no hard and fast way to know where something's going to happen. One thing that our city council did this year is they allowed us to hire two new positions, which one is dedicated to leak detection, which means they will go out and listen in our system and identify leaks, and hopefully we can stay ahead of the leaks before they become catastrophic. Before something happens, you know, we can repair those kind of leaks on our time rather than, you know, wait for the line to fail.
Yeah. And can you explain a little bit about how you fund both the operations of the utility as well as the repairs? Where does that money come from? What are your mandates in terms of balancing your budget
Well, our operations come strictly from the from our users, from our ratepayers. To fund these repair and replacement projects, we fund some of it out of our cash reserve that, as I mentioned earlier, comes from our system development charges and goes into a cash reserve specified for those repair and replacement projects, expansions of the water plant, wastewater plant, whatever the need is. And some of the projects are actually funded through our operating, our expenditure budget, which is again the ratepayers.
Yeah.
So we try to balance where we can those costs.
Yeah. And you guys talked a little bit briefly about rate increases that you guys have done over the last few years. I think, as I understand it, you go to city council as your
right.
governing body.
That's
that
right.
Either approve or disapprove.
That's right. And typically, when we did our water plant renovation, we borrowed about $10 million, and the balance of that came out of that cash reserve, which was another almost $10 million. Well, to pay for that debt service that we were acquiring, we looked ahead of time and said, okay, how can we get our rates up to a point where we can pay that debt service with our expenditure, you know, through our rates? And we did that over a 3-year period. You know, we advertised it, we let everybody know what we were doing, and it went very well. You know, I personally like to see rates increased a little bit as you go along, rather than having these huge increases, which just...
That's when you get the calls.
Oh, yes.
Kim, I want to pass a question off to you and then to Representative McGrady, but
okay.
Can you talk a little bit about funding water infrastructure from the state level? I know there were some major changes in, I think, 2009. If you can talk a little bit how it was done, how we're doing it now, and then also touch on the bond vote
sure.
coming up in March.
Well, a couple of years ago, it was actually 2013, the water infrastructure funding programs across the state were consolidated into the Division of Water Infrastructure, which was a brand new division created with, at that time, Diener, now Department of Environmental Quality. And you had grant programs that were in the rural center. Clean Water Management Trust Fund could do some infrastructure funding. USDA Rural Development had some grant and loan mix. Of course, that's a federal program, so it stayed where it was. Community Development Block Grant Program, administered by the Department of Commerce, could do infrastructure funding. Our two largest funding programs, both the Clean Water State Revolving Loan Program, which is for wastewater projects, and the Drinking Water State Revolving Fund Loan Program, we were administering, but even within Diener, those two state revolving funds were administered by two different divisions. And so all of that came together. There was a smaller state program that was, again, split between wastewater and drinking water. And with that consolidation, also the legislature created the State Water Infrastructure Authority, which is a 9-member board. And you know, we're working really hard to simplify the funding process and get it really focused. And one of the things I really liked about the legislation was it charged the State Water Infrastructure Authority with developing a master plan for the state's water infrastructure needs, not just approving projects here and there, but actually putting together a plan so that project approval and prioritization and how these programs all operate are going to really hopefully operate in concert with each other and in concert with the state's needs. And so that's kind of what we're doing. Our biggest programs are the revolving fund programs, which I really like from a conceptual standpoint, because we get federal money in, we have to match it with state money. We loan it out. It's not a grant program, it's a loan program, and those loan repayments have to come back in so we can loan them back out again.
Yeah.
So it's a consistent funding source for a lot of our small and medium-sized towns. Now, we can't touch the needs at Charlotte, Raleigh. We will fund maybe one or two little projects that they may have, but for the most part, they're on their own. And in North Carolina, we're fortunate that those large urban areas are growing. They've got AAA bond ratings, interest rates are really low. So the interest rates we offer are not that different from what they can get.
Yeah.
Now for a smaller community, it's a lot harder to get that bond rating and get into the bond market, and that's where we really can step in.
And I would imagine from a statewide level as well, it seems to me in my reporting, the smaller rural communities are the ones that are really struggling to fund their infrastructure projects.
Yeah.
Is that what it looks like from the statewide?
It sure does. And it's, and of course the bond bill will really help that. That's a really a significant infusion, particularly for our state program, which has a loan program as well. That's a revolving loan. Again, we get to use that money over and over again, but grants as well, because a lot of our small systems need that kind of grant money to get them up and over the top. You know, we, as Lee, you know, talked about, it's a lot of really, really old infrastructure. And it's when you've had 100 years of depreciation and you haven't built up capital reserves and you suddenly are faced with this infrastructure is aging out. You know, a lot of the pipe was designed to last, you know, 70 to 100 years. Well, if it was put in 1920, we're there. At the same time, a lot of our smaller communities have lost manufacturing base, and which was a lot of times their biggest water customer. And so revenues in a lot of cases are down. And in some cases, you know, with the bigger towns and bigger systems, we've encouraged people to conserve water. And again, that drives revenues down.
Yeah.
A lot of your operating expenses are fixed.
Right.
As Lee would probably you know, confirm. And with all that happening at the same time, yeah, they really need some help. And even the loan program, yeah, it's loan, they have to be able to pay back the debt. But the interest rate savings has about somewhere between a 15 to 30% grant equivalent over the life of that loan. And so it's a substantial savings for a lot of our communities.
Yeah, yeah. Representative McGrady, I wonder if you could speak a little bit about what it looks like from the General Assembly level in terms of funding water projects, and just a little bit about informing folks about the bond vote in March and what that looks like.
Well, I'll start with the letter piece. That's a $2 billion bond. It's got a little over $300 million of that is water infrastructure. That's a pretty big commitment. The other pieces have to do with community college, university systems, and a range of other things, including the National Guard. But it was recognized we've got a lot more in water infrastructure needs across the state. Mostly the need is a lot of mill towns who, you know, just as you've explained, have and their water infrastructure, their sewer infrastructure is failing. If the sewer infrastructure fails, it's going to quickly affect your water because it's going to cost a lot more to clean it up as it heads downstream. So we found ourselves this year with moving from the bond, we found ourselves this year with, to the surprise of many, a little bit of a budget surplus. And The feeling at the General Assembly was that with one-time monies, which is what that is, putting money towards things like water infrastructure was a good thing. So there were, I don't remember all the numbers, but there were additive millions of dollars put towards water infrastructure, sewer straight infrastructure, but also, you know, state parks and a range of other things.
Yeah. Yeah, and what's your thoughts about the bond? What are the political feelings about the bond passing in March? Is it something that would
the governor
support?
Signed it the last day or two, and he's on the road as we speak. I support it. What I liked about the bond is that it's diverse. So we're not just going out there and trying to sell, you know, bond for higher ed. It's got a little bit of everything, and really will affect a broad swath of North Carolina. and hopefully that will garner the support that we need, because certainly the infrastructure need is there.
Well, I want to shift gears a little bit to one of the larger water issues in Western North Carolina, a system that rhymes with Nashville. And I don't want to belabor the debate about the fate of Asheville's water system tonight. It's certainly been the subject of a lot of healthy community discussion, but we would be remiss if we did not talk about it. Because as it happens, events have favored the timing of our forum tonight. There have been some recent significant developments in the fate of a law that would transfer Asheville system to a regional authority. Just a couple of weeks ago, you may well have heard that the State Court of Appeals effectively green-lighted the law. And subsequently, the city of Asheville voted unanimously in closed session to appeal the transfer up to the state Supreme Court, which is an appeal they'll file very soon, we're all led to believe. So this ongoing issue for many years has had many participants, among them Representative McGrady, so we want to get his perspective on that. As Angie mentioned, we invited City of Asheville representatives, none of which were able to make it with us tonight. So I'll take the liberty of quoting Mayor Manheimer's reaction to recent developments. As for the court ruling, she said, "I'm deeply disappointed, and I think this is a big loss for the citizens of Asheville and also for the citizens of North Carolina." In the newspaper, the Citizen Times paraphrased her as saying, "If the decision stands, it would reduce the ability of local governments across the state to manage their affairs," she said. So Chuck, I know you've been down this road before, but I'm wondering if you could give us your 60 to 90 second take on why you think this transfer is a good idea. And I know that's a very short period, but.
My take on it is, I come at it from an environmental perspective. I was an environmental advocate before I became a public official. 20 years ago, the solution to our water issues was the development of a regional water authority. We tried to have one. It wasn't a real authority. It was contractual. And ultimately, the localities backed out of that, and we were left with what we have. I think you look at water as water in and water out, meaning if we didn't have counties and cities, you were designing water and sewer infrastructure, you design it around in a regional fashion. As to what the river basins are. And the municipal sewer district in Buncombe County is largely responsible for cleaning up the French Broad River. It has worked. It has done exactly what the General Assembly wanted done. And so in this case, rather than put the water authority under one political government, even though that water is the system itself came from different governments, and the water goes in different places. We put it into a different type of local government. It's a local water authority. It'll have lots of elected officials on there, reflective of what that water and sewer authority will do. And I frankly think it's the right governance method. And it's also the right method in terms of protecting the water quality of the area. There's a lot of litigation on this. It goes back into the 1930s. And I don't want to get too critical here, but history is replete with the city of Asheville using its water as a weapon against its neighbors. And this will not allow that to happen, because it will be a regional asset managed by a group of local officials from a number of different jurisdictions.
Thank you. Katie, I wonder, as someone who's paid a lot of attention to this debate from a pretty learned perspective the last few years, I'm wondering what perspectives you have on the transfer of the system.
Sure. Well, and Representative McGrady knows that I respectfully disagree with some of his position on this, but actually our organization doesn't necessarily think that regional approaches to water are bad. In fact, in many cases, they can work really well. And the issue that I see as the biggest sticking point with the transfer is just sort of the process that has gone through, that this was not a decision that our communities made by coming together. It was something that was legislated in Raleigh, and in fact, the referendum on the ballot the year the legislation passed in Asheville showed the majority opposed to that transfer. Of course, that referendum was only within the city of Asheville. Our concern really with this is that it has set a precedent now across the state, which is one example of several in which the General Assembly has been really forceful in local affairs. And actually, as Mayor Mannheimer had implied, that for other towns and cities across the state, this may kind of make it feel like they're walking on quicksand, in the sense that if they're investing in a water system that then is taken away, transferred to another entity by the General Assembly, then they no longer have that asset and there's no compensation. That could be a huge detriment, and as we've already heard tonight, it's already hard enough for these municipalities and counties to make these investments in their systems over time. I guess the other point that I would make is our organization, you know, we really espouse the concept of a lot of public input into decisions about water. So we're all about the models for managing drinking water that get the most public voice in it. And by moving the system from an elected body to an appointed body, there is a level of separation, in a sense, from the public that is, you know, just one level different. So you're not necessarily going to cast a vote for these people. In the different areas, people will cast votes, but then those bodies will appoint people to the regional board. It's just something to think about. It's hard to say how that will play out, but that has definitely been a concern of ours in watching the whole thing.
I see. Thank you. So far. Lee, I wanted to see if I could put you on the spot and see if you have any feelings about the proposed transfer and merging of these systems.
Well, you know, speaking as a member of a public utility, certainly I would be concerned, you know, if I were Asheville, or, yeah, certainly I'm concerned.
What are your concerns?
Well, as Katie said, you know, we feel like that what we're doing is what's best for our customers in repairing and replacing our infrastructure, putting new infrastructure in place to prepare for the future. And I guess to have that just taken away, you just don't know. I guess you kind of hesitate before you spend the capital, not knowing what might happen.
Chuck, how do you feel about those concerns, in particular the matter of local systems being directed in this fashion out of Raleigh?
They're not being directed out of Raleigh. The Metropolitan Sewer and Water District will be directed by local officials in this area. And we've got a great model with the Metropolitan Sewer District. But for what the Raleigh did, what would the French Broad be like? There's a difference between Asheville and Hendersonville. They're in the same river system, but Asheville has nearly 100 years of using its water as a weapon against its neighbors. The city of Hendersonville has not. You could make an argument for bringing the city of Hendersonville's water and sewer into it, but frankly, the issue is more on the sewer side, because it doesn't make economic sense because of the cost, the embedded capital in the sewer side of the Hendersonville system. But, I mean, we met with the city council and mayor of Hendersonville. I think there had been the same history that we had in Asheville that has led to local acts like this, not just under Republicans, but the last time it was under Democrats, where the city, you know, either took money out of the system and used it for city purposes, or use the system against his neighbors, we probably wouldn't have gone down this road. But the history here is really what dictated it. If, in fact, the water authority that everybody envisioned back in the 1990s had worked, we wouldn't have gotten to the position we were with this legislation.
Well, I'll drop the topic in short order, but Chuck, I wanted you to look into your legislative crystal ball for us and ponder if by some chance the state Supreme Court decides this law is a no-go, what might be the next step from the General Assembly regarding a proposed transfer?
I don't want to be smart, but there are other ways to skin the cat. There are other ways to draft that legislation depending on what the U.S., you know, the North Carolina Supreme Court says, I guess, to make sure that we do things constitutionally. But at this point in time, a unanimous Court of Appeals panel has determined what was done was constitutional. Since it was a unanimous decision, there's not a right, automatic right of appeal, apparently. And so the North Carolina Supreme Court's going to have to make a conscious decision that it wants to hear this case. Otherwise, the Court of Appeals decision will be the law, and we will be merging the sewer district with the water district. And, you know, they've got a lot of money. They've got very good bond rating, and I expect the infrastructure needs of the city, counties involved here will be taken care of by the new authority.
Thank you.
I'm going to switch gears a little bit. One of the bits of reporting that we did is a trend statewide, maybe nationally as well, is investor-owned utilities that are acquiring typically smaller water systems. Just to give you some quick statistics, I mentioned these at the beginning, but among the 300 or so roughly water systems in western North Carolina, 80% of them are privately owned, and some of those are very tiny water systems that may serve like a mobile home park or something like this. But we're seeing a growing number of utilities that are owned by investor-owned utilities, by corporate ownership, and really it's dominated by two large national corporations, Utilities Incorporated, which has some subsidiaries, and then Aqua USA, or Aqua North Carolina, as it goes by in North Carolina. And we did, as Angie mentioned, we invited Tom Roberts, who's the CEO of Aqua, who we spoke with. They have a small presence here in western North Carolina, much more in the Piedmont and the east. He does predict that there will be a growing trend of these struggling, smaller municipal systems who, as Kim mentioned, can't keep up necessarily with repairs. And he made an argument saying that they're pretty well suited for being able to do that job. And I wanted to ask Katie to give us your thoughts on specifically investor-owned utilities, what the landscape looks like, and your perspective on that, you know, trend.
Sure. Well, first and foremost, our organization has been highly concerned by investor-owned utilities and some of the things we've seen in terms of impacts to customer rates and the service they're receiving. In North Carolina, as you said, those are the two biggest companies. There actually are a lot of other companies nationally that are involved in this scene. So Aqua North Carolina and then Utilities Inc., which their biggest subsidiary is called Carolina Water Service. Some people may have heard of them because they do have some systems in western North Carolina. I would first say that in terms of how that's been happening, it has been these rural neighborhoods or suburban areas that, for whatever reason, did not connect up to a public water supply. I think a lot of this was going on back in the 80s when a lot of sprawl was happening outside of cities. And so there would be a community well. And then when whoever had put the well in and operated it for a while couldn't keep up anymore, they were looking for an easy solution. That's how these companies got a foothold in North Carolina. And we've been in touch with a lot of the communities who get this service. Their water rates and sewer rates are some of the highest in the state. And that's because the companies, you know, by nature, get a rate of return. So the North Carolina Utilities Commission regulates rates much like they would do for Duke Energy or another utility that is privately owned. But again, the Utilities Commission is a board that's appointed by, in the state, and it's not always been the most responsive. So these companies do tend to have very large rate hikes. And at the same time, while we were hearing about good forward-thinking practices by the city of Hendersonville, for example, well, where might a pipe fail and how can we get out and predict what our needs will be? When these companies are concerned about their bottom line, they tend to cut on staff, they tend to cut on how much maintenance they're able to do. So in a lot of cases, we do hear of a lot of problems and slow response times, even while the rates are climbing. So we feel it's a big issue. I will also say that our organization has been talking to a lot of these small rural water system directors and county managers, and we're hearing that they're not really interested. So although Mr. Roberts said that his company is interested in buying municipal systems, we haven't really seen a lot of municipalities in North Carolina get to that point yet. They're hanging on, and frankly, I think that they are concerned about what's best for their customers and know that the rates would likely increase if they went with a private company. So at this point, you know, there have been some approaches by private companies, but municipalities have ended up turning them down for the most part.
But I'm guessing as we move forward, you know, the next decade or couple of decades, as these, you know, little mill towns or small towns have lost their manufacturing base, I'm guessing that, do you envision that this issue is going to rise to the surface a little more? Are we going to be hearing more about investor-owned utilities in Western North Carolina?
We may be. I think we'll also be hearing a lot more about regional cooperation, though. And, you know, for example, one thing that Charlotte and Raleigh have going for them is they have a huge customer base to pay for all of their needs. Whereas in a rural county with a lot of water line to maintain, and then just one customer here, one customer there, it's a lot harder to do that. But, you know, if there's a county with a few towns and, you know, everybody can kind of agree, let's cooperate on this, in some instances that can be, you know, a really helpful solution. And it may be that the investor-owned utilities don't necessarily need a seat at that table. I think that the public has a lot of input into that, or should, and should be, you know, watching for those kinds of deals and thinking about, is this best for our community? And, you know, speaking out to local officials if that kind of deal is on the table at some point.
Have there been mergers around the state? Is that popping up on the Piedmont and East? Are you seeing that there?
There is a lot of cooperation and regional systems or county city systems. So you may be able to speak to that a little more than I am, actually. But I think there are a lot that exist. When we talk to people, they usually say, oh yeah, you know, we also give water to this town or the city. So it is going on, but I'm not sure.
Do you want to take that?
Well, I'll comment about a couple of things. We're going kind of back to the investor-owned utilities, and you know, I guess a bit of disclosure. I used to work for a privately owned public utility back in the 90s that eventually got bought out by Heater, which got bought out by Aqua. So some of those Aqua systems are some of the ones that I used to work with. And we would, you know, go in and work with developers, and the alternative was it's either the public utility or the homeowner association. And of course, you know, at that time, you know, when you're working with the public utility, the perspective is, well, you know, we have the experts on staff to run that. A homeowner association may happen to have a wastewater treatment plant operator or a well operator in the subdivision, you don't know. And certainly there's a profit part of that in operating that. But I think they do have their place. And in a lot of cases, the rates are because of the profit going to be higher. In some cases, it's because they're putting more into the infrastructure and they earn that rate of return on that investment, that capital investment back in. When we, it's a, with the utility that I owned, whenever a town came through and was annexing that subdivision, we never held out. If they gave us a reasonable price for the system, we just signed it right over. And we had a lot of systems in the Charlotte area, and Charlotte was really expanding. Charlotte Mecklenburg Utilities was taking over a lot of the subdivisions, and you know, they would come in and say, okay, we're going to offer service in this subdivision, and in a couple of weeks the deal was done. There wasn't just a lot of going back and forth. So when the public entity was there and ready to serve, it was, for us, it was a pretty smooth transition. Now, is it that way with Utilities Incorporated or Aqua now? I don't know. But from a regional cooperation, you know, one of the things that the State Water Infrastructure Authority is really looking at is best management practices with utilities and where some of the needs in a lot of utilities are, particularly in the small towns. And you know, not every small town has somebody like Lee who can has that expertise, 30 years of experience, and sees the need for capital investment and that sort of thing. We have towns that we're working with where there's 100 customers. The mayor is the mayor by write-in vote. All the council members are written in because nobody runs. They tied in their sewer system to the county system, but the county didn't take them over. And they have a lot of old pipe. They've tried to rehabilitate it, but they didn't really have the expertise to manage the construction project. It didn't work out as well as they would have liked. They're actually paying the county or the municipality that serves them about a 4-to-1 ratio. About for every gallon of wastewater that they generate, they're actually paying for about 5 gallons at the treatment plant because they have that much I&I. And you know, their rates are about $100 a month because they're paying for all that extra water.
Yeah.
And it's a very, very difficult situation, and you know, nobody wants them, right? I mean, you don't want to penalize your customers if you're the rescuing system and assume that debt, because there's an infrastructure debt there, right? I mean, they've not renewed that 100-year-old system, and the more you defer those continual capital improvements, you're running an infrastructure debt. It's not a debt, a monetary debt yet.
Yet,
but it will be. And the cost of construction, if you look at the construction cost index that's published by the Engineering News Record, since the 50s, it always goes up. In the early 80s, it slowed down a little bit, but even in the last recession we had, it didn't really slow down that much. And since the 80s, it's averaging just under 3%. So that's your cost of that deferral with renewal. And so it's just a very difficult situation for a lot of these. And it's one of the things that the authority recommended to the legislature, and the legislature passed this session in the budget, was consolidation study grants, so that we can offer a study where systems can come together. And a lot of these small systems can't pay for the engineering fees, and that gives them an avenue to get that study done, see what's the best choice for them. And so hopefully that'll help encourage a lot of regional cooperation.
Yeah.
Speaking of regional cooperation, I wanted to tie up or end up our panel tonight by talking about another specific, robbed from the headlines story about a regional water system. And that is, in Polk County, there's been a very unique situation for the past year wherein the county has been negotiating with a neighboring water district in South Carolina about a very long-term transfer of Polk's relatively small public water system. There were, in contract negotiations, consideration of transferring the system for 75 years to this neighboring authority, and that was a red flag to a lot of folks. A majority of Polk's Board of Commissioners favored the move. However, the contract negotiations were scuttled just about 10 days ago by the South Carolina Water District, who had hired a consultant and decided that they, under the contract that's currently written, that that district would not benefit in ways it hoped it might, that its customers might not be well served by it, and taking on in particular 75 years worth of dam maintenance at Lake Adger could be a costly commitment. All of which is to say, for all the heat that went into this debate, it ultimately proved unworkable, this unique arrangement. And I wanted to see just how unique of an arrangement it is to have public water systems crossing state lines from North Carolina to a neighboring state. And Kim, I thought maybe you could let us know if there's much in the way of precedent for that. I wasn't able to find much. We'll start with that.
Well, I know Grand Strand Water and Sewer Authority down in Myrtle Beach goes into North Carolina in Columbus County. And that was an avenue to serve those folks because there wasn't a strong regional presence in Columbus County. It's a lot of smaller systems. And obviously the Myrtle Beach area is really growing. They have, you know, a lot of resources there. There's a lot of development push coming up toward that area. And of course, from a Grand Strand Water and Sewer Authority standpoint, it had to make sense for them to do that from a business standpoint. But there's not a lot. Now, there's a lot of, you know, water drawn on one side of the border and discharge, and it goes over across the border. So there's a lot of that in the Roanoke Basin. Obviously, our largest wastewater treatment plant sits just a couple hundred feet from the South Carolina border in Charlotte, and you know that's going right into South Carolina. Does it make sense for the treatment plant to have to be located right there just because that's where the border is, or you know, should it be somewhere else? So you know, I think it's just there's not a lot of it there, and a lot of it is you know, things like permitting and some of the real basic things. When the NPDES permit system was developed by the federal government, it was delegated to the states. States have different philosophies, and it's like our state revolving funds. The federal government gives us a lot of leeway on how we structure those programs. So the joke with EPA is, you know, there's 51 programs, 50 states and Puerto Rico, and there's 51 different ways of running a state revolving fund as a result. So, and you know, some of it's that kind of legacy of how permitting is done and that sort of thing as well.
I was following that Polk debate very closely, and one of the tensions that arose was the fact that a water agreement crossing state lines would need to grapple with the fact that state laws aren't identical in neighboring states. A lot of federal regulations would sort of settle a lot of the issues as to water quality and what have you. But some interesting nuances came up. For example, the board that would oversee this agreement would have members from both sides of the border, and they would need to operate under some sort of transparency provisions. The contract as written said that that board would operate under the open meetings and open records laws of both North Carolina and South Carolina. But those laws are different on some finer points. And so I was curious to see how that would work going forward. We're not going to find out in this particular case. I talked to some transparency advocates who said, well, hot diggity, you've got a board that's subject to twice as many openness laws. You can cite the one that favors the most disclosure. It's an interesting wrinkle that I hadn't thought of myself. Just to wrap us up here before we go to your questions, one thing I noticed in the Polk debates, Lee, was how much local public systems are often collaborating with neighboring systems already, even without super long-term agreements. In what ways does Hendersonville partner with neighbors, and how does that work?
Well, the way we've done it for years is, first of all, we're interconnected with Asheville in a couple different places, and we've actually utilized their Mills River plant when our plant was being renovated. We actually became their largest customer for about 2 years. So we have that. We, as I mentioned earlier, we provide water to Saluda We also provide water to the town of Laurel Park. And of course, Fletcher is sort of a mix. Some of it's served by the city of Asheville, and some of it is served by the city of Hendersonville. But as far as cooperating regionally, it's not unusual for us to talk about that weekly.
Mm-hmm.
And as far as talking to other local governments, we do that as well. And, I guess we don't really put a lot of thought into the fact that we're doing it, we just do it. We don't plan to talk about those kinds of things. The way we do business.
Gotcha.
Let me add something there, though. There's another side of this. Water infrastructure drives growth. And one thing Hendersonville and Henderson County have done is they've got an understanding as to where they are not going to put water. Because where Hendersonville puts water is going to drive growth, perhaps in areas of the county that the county doesn't want to grow, for whatever set of reasons. And so one of the things that has worked well in Henderson County, I think, is that cooperation. Hendersonville has the water system. Henderson County has no water system. And yet there's an agreement that really affects water and how the county is growing, that grows out of the water system that the city runs.
Yeah, our city council will not consider adding a new development or whatever it might be until the planning jurisdiction in which that development is in has approved.
I see. Very good. Well, thank you to you all. We're going to unleash the hounds in the room tonight. We want to hear your questions, and Angie's going to...
Yeah. Do we have any questions tonight? Anyone? Frank.
So I have a question coming out of something that Ken mentioned, and it's actually a question I think though for Katie, but I should explain. By the way, I'm Frank Taylor. I'm with Carolina Public Press and recently have joined the team there. But earlier this year, I was working for the Fayetteville Observer, and a few months before the end of the year, we had an occasion to meet with Mr. Roberts of Aqua, and he came and talked to us, and he wanted to talk about some nightmare litigation. We had the City Public Works Administration that was suing the city, but we had some interesting things happening in Fayetteville, but specifically, Aqua had resisted annexation. When annexations had taken place in that jurisdiction, they said, we don't want to sell, and you can't make us. Mm-hmm. And we asked Mr. Roberts about this. We're hearing a lot of complaints from your customers about the water quality, the same types of things that we're hearing in Western North Carolina about investor-owned systems. And he was, pretty quick in his response. He said, we're not going to sell. In fact, maybe we ought to buy Fayetteville system. My question to Katie is, based on that kind of policy attitude from the bigger investor-owned companies, is there a problem with our regulatory model that we can't do anything to make them provide better customer service, better responsive adjustments to the system? And is there a better model in other states for handling that?
Well, that's a lot of questions, but they're good questions. And first off, I would say that that's been our experience with Aqua as well. I've been in this line of work researching these companies for about 6 years, and I do think that's one of the shifts that has happened in taking over the more local companies and then buying these systems that were more locally based. Is the bigger that you get, and Aqua is a very large company based in Pennsylvania, so they have these out-of-state customer service centers, for example, things like that, that a more local company might not have quite as many concerns. But one of their business strategies, Aqua America specifically, is that they are very resistant to selling. Now, they have sold some systems in Charlotte due to annexation, I know, and maybe finalizing sale of another, but I think you do tend to get that approach, and it's pretty frustrating. One thing we haven't talked about at all tonight, but is a big component of where drinking water comes from here in the West, as well as throughout the state, is private wells. And I know a lot of people are on private wells that are, you know, experiencing various levels, but whether private or public, well water tends to have some things in it. And I think to respond to your question about the regulatory model, there are a lot of issues that are keeping customers from holding these utilities fully accountable in some instances. For example, something that we hear all the time is the community wells owned by a private company just have naturally occurring iron and manganese in them. Now, iron and manganese are not going to kill you, but they make the water brown or black, and when the water comes out of your tap and it's brown, most people don't want to drink that. But there's no way for the state, public water supply can't hold anyone accountable. And so the company kind of has to want to provide good service. People can call and complain all they want, but they're going to be told, oh no, your water is fine, it's perfectly safe to drink, at the same time that the rates are climbing. So, you know, we believe that there are a number of loopholes that make it pretty easy for these companies to quietly, you know, really affect people's quality of life in some instances. And just one other thing I'll say to that is, you know, we're talking about consolidating systems, looking into that approach, as well as sort of planning and development and how that interacts with water. We've looked somewhat into policies that Alabama put in place, of all places, back in the 80s, which ended up preventing a lot of this small, you know, proliferation of small private systems. And it essentially was language in the state policy that said, you know, a system needs to make every effort to hook up to a public municipal system. But, you know, obviously it's what's done is done here in North Carolina. But I've always thought that that was an interesting model to look at for North Carolina. So, as we go forward.
Thank you, Katie. Paul, you had a question?
Yeah, Katie, you brought up in relation to the Asheville seizure, and you also mentioned it in talking about investor-owned utilities, the importance of having voters engaged in the system. Why is that important? I'm curious for your answer and then from the board.
Okay, well, I just talked a lot, so I'll keep mine short.
Yeah.
I think it's important because if people aren't watching, decisions can be made that will affect the future. For example, in Polk County, if residents had not gotten involved and gotten really active with the county, that would have been a 75-year contract that's now, you know, gone back to the drawing board for some other solution in that area. But when people are paying attention, and especially if there are good, transparent, you know, governance models in place, there's really an opportunity to be a part of those decisions. And if it's not a great, transparent governance model, then it's really important for people to be watching that and speaking out and trying to get to that place. I mean, there's not an unlimited supply of water, and this, I think, is going to be a really important issue going forward.
Yeah, I'll just add, you know, I think as the authority is looking at management issues across North Carolina and how we can kind of make the local decisions better, there's a lot of information that seems to be missing in a lot of the discussion. And I think whether it's an authority, a water and sewer authority, or a city-owned system, or whatever that case may be, the more information about what the real situation is for that utility, the better. You know, we see within a lot of the small systems where the finance people have limited expertise and they don't really talk to the public works director who may have limited expertise. And then when you put those together at the staff level, they have a hard time conveying a unified message to the council, who then has a hard time working with the citizens. There's missing pieces of information. What is the cost to defer that project? What's the risk of doing it today or not? And having that open dialogue. And that's one of the things that the authority is going to really be looking at closely over the next couple of years, to see how we can, what kind of information and resources we can either facilitate getting into that discussion or actually providing as a part of that discussion.
I have a real strong preference actually for, you know, public ownership of water. And the reason for that, I guess, is when it's being owned and managed by a private entity, it's treated as a commodity. And frankly, it's not a commodity. And our law hasn't, you know, sort of caught up on this, and you can still stick your pipe in the ground and bring your water out and it's your water. And there's, you know, a huge number of issues that, you know, are historical in nature that cause us to be where we are. But I generally agree. I think the state policy is moving to push for more regional cooperation. We're putting incentives by being willing to fund through loan and grant programs water infrastructure. So the state policy, I think, is behind more public ownership and operation of these systems and consolidation. It's just not something you can do with the click of the fingers and their, you know, due process considerations and other things that are out there. But I would love to make sure we don't treat water as a commodity. And I think private sector is going to generally do that.
You, sir.
Thank you. Representative McGrady, I was just curious. I'm from outside the area. I moved here 6 months ago. I don't know the local history, so I wanted to know from you, how has Asheville used water as a weapon against its neighbors?
I won't try to answer that at great length. There's an appellate court decision of several years ago dealing with the constitutionality of the Democrats' efforts to rein in the city of Asheville, which gives you a rather long history of how the city has used water rates. Mostly it's been about differential rates, charging one amount in the city and one amount somewhere else, which would make a lot of sense if it was completely just the city of Asheville's water system. But the city of Asheville's water system, in fact, was in part the county system and in part a range of other pieces. And so the differential water piece has been the most recent issue. And I think legislators probably feel like if given the chance and change in political climate, that's where we'll end up back again, just like we were in the 1930s, and we've been on 30 or 50 year cycles. And by setting up something regional, hopefully all the regional political leaders can work this out. We've got a really good model that's worked on the sewer side that has been very good for the environment also.
Three questions. I'll ask them one at a time. Anybody can answer. From what you're saying, we have deferred maintenance, a big bomb on our lap, and we haven't done much about it over the last 100 years. We haven't charged the ratepayer, and we really haven't maintained the system. How big's the bomb? Take your whole rate base of operations. Whatever you're paying for water across the whole state, how much bigger is the capital cost? 10 times?
You have a guess on
Well, we do with EPA a need survey every 4 years, one for clean water and in other years, one for drinking water. And the drinking water needs are about $10 billion. The clean water needs are about $6 billion over 20 years.
Compared to what? You got to give me a comparison. How much do we pay in water bills?
I don't know that off the top of my head.
When you say $10 billion, it just goes right over my head.
Yeah, I know. And that's known needs, right? And there's a lot of infrastructure, as we were talking about earlier, it's buried underground. How do you know what really needs
to
be
replaced? So how big is it?
That's not a question anybody can really answer.
Don't we think we should?
And that's one of the things we're working on with the authority is better assessing those needs. And we're actually getting ready to have a project started with the Environmental Finance Center and UNC to try to better quantify those needs.
It seems to me that the rates have to go up. Whether it's private or public, they're going up because somebody's got to spend the money to fix the system.
And I think that's right, and I think rates have to go up regardless.
Yeah,
the
doesn't make any
cost
difference.
Of construction is always going up. Chemical cost, leak, is always going up, I'm assuming.
Oh, yes.
Wages are going
operating.
Up.
This is, we're talking about the physical plant has not been maintained.
But that all goes into the same rate.
By hundreds of local governments across the state.
Absolutely.
And
across the nation.
To put it in a different way, this is something that came to the legislature as we were looking at how to spend the money. We're talking about water and sewer infrastructure here, but there would be 30 or 40 cities that if they actually started to address the things that they're supposed to address, they would be functionally bankrupt.
Right.
And the number is much more close to 100 if they, very, very, there are a large number of cities like that. A lot of them, again, are mill towns. It's a lot more down east generally than out west.
Everybody's got their problems.
Yeah.
But the deferred maintenance is the problem.
And the fact that rates have
everybody not, has avoided you know, the rate increase and the deferred maintenance.
And political people running the towns don't want to sometimes raise those rates, and they put them off, and we've dug ourselves a hole.
Yeah, just to add on, and talking to a lot of various water systems is, you know, public water systems are the answer to a board or a city council, so it's very political in terms of raising rates, and that's a huge challenge.
Everything is political.
Being able to do it, absolutely.
But it's better on the water side than the sewer side, because most towns can make money on water, in theory, better than they can on sewer. It's just a much larger problem.
If I might just say to your question, if you're interested in this stuff, Kim mentioned the UNC Environmental Finance Center. They have an excellent, I highly recommend their water and sewer rates dashboard. It's very easy to understand. You can look up all these towns and see, are they recovering their costs? Are they keeping rates affordable? There are all these little dials. It's like a car dashboard. And because that really is something that has to go into these decisions, is you've got to recover costs, but you also can't necessarily raise rates to the point where people can't pay them. So I'd encourage you to explore that because it's got some really good visual information.
That's really good.
Yes, sir.
The dashboard you brought up, I have taken a look at that. It's a good process, but I think you need to go way back to where towns and stuff begin to incorporate, become a town. It was a need because people were moving in and wanting services. Well, those services over the time, just that they're speaking, is that your local government, it's the people that have taken in for, say, your council and says, okay, you're not going to raise my rates whatsoever. None can be. You're not going to raise it. That's one of the reasons why it fails. It's not only, you can't just say that it's people that's elected. It's because the people don't want it going up, and that's the only control we got. The difference if you go to Aqua and you sell to them is you lose that control.
Right.
You don't have that control anymore over your rates because they go to the Public Utility Commission, and if they can take and make a case, such as Duke Power or whatever, that their needs and their cost to operations, they're going to get those rate increases.
But I think you're going to. Do you have a question for any of them?
The question is that I will have to, I would say, the whole board. If you take and transfer, sell, whatever like that, you've still got that cost and somebody's going to pay for it. And it's the same people that's going to end up paying for it. in the long run. It's the same people that the customers, whatever, the money's coming from the same source. I think that they need to look at a whole different way to do. But my question to the board is, if all this transfers or sales, such as Pope County, is where's that money going to come from? We've still got the same problems.
I'll just offer up that if you look at the general accounting standards requirements for government systems, and you look at the local government finance laws here in North Carolina, they all mirror each other. And for water and sewer utilities, they're supposed to be operated as an enterprise system. And so that's where the money has to come from.
In the past, the federal government had put a lot more into grant programs, which turned into loan programs. And there are some people who argue that there should be more federal funding, because I think nationally it's something like $600 billion in the next 20 years. At this point, that's something that would have to happen federally, but that could be potentially another additive source.
Those ratepayers are going to pay, but I think the trend from the General Assembly is likely to be, we recognize the issue. We've begun to fund it recently. We changed how we put our funds out, and I think there's broad support for continuing to try to put more money towards infrastructure, help local governments to address their infrastructure needs of whatever nature, but particularly water and water and sewer.
To clarify, when you were talking about the bond in March, that's something that all of us can vote on in the primary election. Is that right? It'll be on the ballot? Okay.
March 15th.
Second question?
Yes, second question, I'll go to Tom.
As you move forward, and I'm not taking a position on Asheville or the suit or all of the bad blood that goes into that, as a taxpayer in Asheville, what would be my incentive to invest anything in the water system in the future from a capital or an increase in the rate base? Why would I do that? Because anything you could do, you could just take away. Across the state, aren't people going to do that? Aren't they going to say, why invest?
No. You're not, as a taxpayer in Asheville, paying for your water system that through your tax base, unless you're doing it wrong, because your water system needs to be paid for through your water system, and the people that are using that water system that are actually a broader base than just the city of Asheville.
Well, I understand that you're talking about the operating expenses. I'm talking about the capital.
No, I am talking about both.
Both. Okay, so what you're saying is because it's a broad base, I should feel comfortable with investing money if they come.
I'm saying you're not investing money through your property taxes.
No, I understand.
Or any, the only way you're investing money is if you're taking water through the system, and you and some number of people that aren't even within the corporate limits of the city of Asheville will be investing in that system because you're a ratepayer. You've just got a different local government. You're going to have a metropolitan sewer and water district, and that's another local government on top of the city of Asheville's government for you.
Tom.
So this is for Lee, because I'm curious, because there was a recent issue, I guess, east of Hendersonville, where people's wells were turning up toxic.
Yes.
And the city had, did the city extend water to that system, to those, the people in
yes.
the area?
Yes, you're referring to the Dana Community
yes.
Academy Road? Yes.
Right. So, I mean, how does that work when the city is controlling areas where the water gets extended to? And how did that, was that, I assume that's outside city limits.
It is.
So I was wondering how that works, and then how those costs are recovered.
Well, in that particular case, the city had water at Dana Elementary School, which was only a few hundred feet from the project, from this area that needed water. We were actually very fortunate to get three grants. The county actually applied for one grant through the Rural Center because the city was not eligible since we had gotten money in 2010 to build an emergency raw water intake to the French Broad River. So they had paid, they had funded that. So the county applied on our behalf or their on behalf of their constituents. We also got a grant from the, it's been a while. We got the other grant from CDBG, Community Development Block Grant. We were able to get a grant from them as well as the Bernard Allen Fund, which as I understand, and Kim, you correct me if I'm wrong, it comes from the tire disposal tax. I think is where they might get some of the funding.
I don't know. That's
no, you are right. It's in a different. It is a fund that's set up to deal with this type of situation. Right. So what he's saying is he got state funding in two pots and federal funding coming through the state in the other to fund the project. In Hendersonville system provides water through a wide part of Henderson County. So the fact that it isn't within the city doesn't is not the issue.
I'd like to piggyback onto that for the community and Dana. Are they now or will they in the future be paying a different rate than inside the city limits?
Well, we do have an outside rate.
Okay. And so other communities that are served outside of the city of Hendersonville, city or town limits, some of them have a different rate.
Yes, and the reason for that is if you look at the density, if you look at per mile density or number of connections, city obviously is much more densely populated. Mm-hmm. So it is less expensive. You can have smaller lines.
Right, and you don't have to pump it as far.
Exactly.
Or as high.
So there is, yes, there are some additional costs that are incurred in a more rural area.
And that's just not been an issue for Hendersonville and Henderson County?
Not within about the last 25 years. You'd have to go back a little while since those entities were fighting with each other over water. Now, if you want to talk about sewer, we can, that's a longer discussion.
Yeah.
Katie had something to add.
I just wanted to comment on that situation in Dana. That was such an excellent example of very quick response by Hendersonville, Henderson County, getting all the funding lined up. And it's there's a huge need for more to be done for private well users. You know, that's not really something that's regulated by the state. People, when they drill a new well since 2008, they have to get it tested. But there's a lot of contamination. There's a lot of great water, but there are also a lot of old underground storage tanks, you know, all kinds of contaminants out there, and, you know, not enough funding for people who do find out their wells are contaminated to do something about it. But that was such a great example. Also, Asheville and Buncombe County running water lines out by the CTS site of just, you know, getting the water to the people who needed it. So I wanted to commend you all on that.
Lots of clarification that actually came up out of both of those points. So Lee, your answer makes perfect sense, but when Representative McGrady answered earlier to your question about a differential rate, that's what I was thinking. So what does differential rate actually mean that I missed?
Well, I think what Representative McGrady was talking about was the fact that it was not all a Asheville system. They had some county system, some other pieces of system, where in our case, outside the city, inside the city, it's all Hendersonville's and has always been. Of course, we have acquired some smaller systems over time.
And still within the county?
Yes.
And so I guess maybe Asheville's goes outside of Buncombe County lines and places.
Asheville's water extends outside of Buncombe County's lines, that's right, into Hendersonville.
Okay.
But you've got it, the differential rate is actually, it's a, the same, we're talking about the same thing, charging different fees for the same water. But there's a different history as between these systems, and every water system around has its own history, and sometimes it dictates inconsistent results.
I guess I would say that, you know, every system, but there's a lot of systems with complex histories in the state, and I guess what my worry is that in this situation, using legislation to fix that is then going to be a precedent for, you know, any time that the state decides that the history isn't favorable, that it's just time to step in.
Yeah.
That's my concern about
right.
this and, how
look back 100 years, and I mean, I've been here 20. I don't know when Asheville's latest using that as a weapon happened because I haven't been paying attention my whole life. I admit it. But, you know, I mean, it does, it seems like it had, you could say it go back as far as you wanted.
So we have time for one more question. Frank, or is it anyone else?
I'll ask my last question. Who owns water in North Carolina? Big issue on the West Coast.
Well, that's right. And Western water law and Eastern water law are very different. And I think my hope would be that, you know, again, I view water as a public right, actually. Republicans don't use that word a lot, but I really don't like you seeing it as simply a commodity. Fact is, though, that if the water goes across your property or under your property, you have the ability to access it.
Not necessarily.
Generally, you do have the ability to access it in some fashion. There may be some regulatory scheme. There's, you know, a lot of private property folks that are very concerned about having their water rights taken away. And as water, up in this area, you know, water used to be something we tried to get rid of. We had too much of it. And as we've grown, it's suddenly become something that's valuable. And so I would tell you that the law is really changing. I mean, these systems are connecting. The state is forcing them to connect because of droughts we had in the past. And we're in a really unique period of time when the law with respect to water, I think, is one drought away from having some, you know, people recognizing we're going to have to do it differently. And if you're in Raleigh and you're dependent upon these big lakes that are getting all algae filled, you've got a very different issue. And if you're on the coast, you know, you got saltwater incursion into these systems. And so the state doesn't hold together in terms of the types of water it has. And I just say, you can't answer that question really well. And the answer to it, I suspect, 50 years from now is going to be different than it is today, my guess. Is that fair?
And just to chime in, I came from a National Forest Planning meeting this afternoon. And you should check that out, because 1.1 million acres and how we manage it, the plan to guide it for the next couple of decades is underway. So a lot of the water that we use comes from those national forests. So that'll have a huge impact on quality, if not exactly who owns it.
Well, thank you. With that, I want to thank all of you for coming tonight. And check out the reporting that John and Jack have been talking about at carolinapublicpress.org. There's several special reports going on that we've been writing about for a year or more. And certainly the Polk County issues we've been writing about since the summer. So, and we've been writing about the Asheville water system for not decades. We've only been around for 5 years.
Yeah, but for fully 5 years.
Yeah.